Welcome to the Dr. Berkson's Best Health Radio Show. Right now, I am in Naples, Florida. So we're not in the studio, so the sound and the sights might not be as clear or as dynamic, but the information is, and our guest is. We have Mike Viola. He is a scientist. This is his home on a gorgeous pond. Yesterday we went boating, but he's going to talk to us about a new way to deal with stress. The world is in a chaotic, stressful place for everybody. So I thought this would be a great show, but I just wanted to keep you up to date on some new information that came out from the Cleveland Clinic and Columbia University. Just a few days ago, the Cleveland Clinic published this very interesting and helpful article for you. They took a look at their database of almost 30,000 patients, and they looked to see who developed COVID, which was a little over 8,000, and what were some interesting variables that they could identify with the people who ended up getting COVID. And they saw that if people were taking melatonin, on the average, they had about a 30% lower risk of getting COVID when they divided this up among ethnicity. If people were African American and taking protective amounts of melatonin before they went to bed at night, they had 52% decreased incidence of getting COVID. Then the Caucasians had about a 23%, but the average was about, if you were taking a little bit of melatonin at night, on the average, you have about a third less chance of developing COVID. They didn't say what dosage, it didn't even matter which dosage. Some people, if they take more than a half of a milligram, they'll be too groggy in the morning. Some people do much better if they have higher dose, especially if they have a history of hormonally driven cancers. So you can take anywhere from a quarter to a half of a milligram of melatonin up to 20 to 30 to 40 milligrams, depending on your body size, your individual health history. But know that it is protective in some way. We're looking at it. We need, of course, they always say larger randomized trials, but it appears as though being on exogenous, where you're buying it from a store and taking it as a pill, endogenous would be if your own body made it. So if you're taking exogenous melatonin from a bottle, from a supplement, it seems to be COVID protective. And Columbia University said, well, let's take a little bit of a deep dive if you're already in the ICU with COVID. And then they discovered that if you're in the ICU and the docs gave you melatonin, let's say you were intubated, you tend to have less downstream adverse effects, such as lung scarring, if you are taking melatonin. Why? Because it's an anti-inflammatory, and this vasculotropic respiratory disease works by huge inflammation, and melatonin tamps down inflammation. So I just wanted to share that with you because that just came out in the news. Well, everybody's stressed out. So now I'm going to really give the show to Dr. Viola. He's a PhD in microbiology. Is that right?
No, surface and colloid chemistry.
Surface and colloid chemistry.
It's close enough for what we want to talk about and what I do when I follow your writings. So
so tell us, I'm visiting here and I've been pretty stressed out about things going on in my own life and the world. And you said, hey, there's this new anti-stress tool.
Yes, not necessarily new, but being rediscovered and being tested. I think a good way to describe this a little bit to your audience is, let me ask you a very simple question. Why do you have two ears? And in fact, why are they on the opposite side of your head? You ever think about that? Why not just one ear?
To be able to hear all the sounds around you?
To know where sound is coming from. So your ears work the same way as your eyes do. So for instance, you remember as a kid, I don't think they're around anymore, and I think your audience is in this range. Remember the ViewMaster?
Right.
Right? And what was that doing? It was separating one view that went in this eye and another view that went in that eye. And when those two views go into your eye, your brain reconstructs three dimensions. You suddenly see depth that wasn't there before. But if you don't separate those two views and you just look at the picture, you only see 2D. So your brain has this amazing ability to independently take information from your sensory input, which includes not only your eyes, but people sort of forget the ears are the same way. So if you put some information in this ear and slightly different information in that ear, the mechanism by which the ear works is that, you know, you've got the cochlea, you got the fluid, you got those little hairs in there. And as the hairs move, it creates electrical signals, goes to your brain, and your brain takes all those neuron firings and it makes something out of it. So if you were to put one sound in one ear and then slightly put a slightly different shift in frequency into the other ear, in the same way that your eye sees one picture and then a slight shift in the picture and reconstructs three dimensions, your ear can do very much the same thing. If you put two tones into each ear, slightly different in frequency, then all of a sudden this new tone, this new frequency appears in your brain and it actually feels like it's inside your brain. So this was discovered in 1839 by a very interesting scientist who was well known in his day. He was a physicist. He published 300 papers, wrote two books. He was the world's first scientific meteorologist. But because he was a scientist, and a lot of us scientists, we tinker and dabble in other things, he somehow was interested in, I wonder what would happen if I put a sound in one ear and a slightly different sound in the other ear. Of course, in those days, they didn't have headphones, they didn't have electronics. So what he did was he took a person and he put a long tube, like a long straw in one ear and another one in the other ear. And at each end, he had a tuning fork and he banged the tuning fork in one and banged the other tuning fork. And when the two sounds came together, the person's eyes opened up and said, wow, I don't hear the sound of a tuning fork. I hear something else. So your brain takes those two differences, subtracts it, and extracts that, and then produces a frequency which your brain processes as a sort of different state of awareness, a different feeling. And so these have, oh, and so then what happened? His research, or that little study that he did, stayed dormant for 125 years. And then in 1973, a psychologist reinvestigated this. And so starting in 1973, there was this popularity of this thing called binaural beats.
How do you spell that?
That's B-I-N-A-U-R-A-L, binaural. And the way to think of it is that there's monaural and there's binaural. In the same way that when you, in the old days, when you put a set of headphones on, it was magic when suddenly you were listening to something in stereo. So when you listen to music in stereo, like of a symphony orchestra, you feel like it's inside your head. You don't quite, feel that you're just listening to it in mono. So that is the difference between what I would call hearing in three dimensions versus hearing in one dimension.
Okay. So you're talking about the ability of putting something on your head where there's slightly different sounds in each ear, and it creates a tone in the brain, which, get this, folks, is very similar to what happens to the brain and very practiced meditators. It's kind of like getting meditation for dummies, where it's created in your brain that other people have to take years to sit and develop, which is why I was really interested in this. And the studies that they're using to show that if you listen for 20 minutes a day to these binaural sounds, the brain relaxes as though you've been a meditator for decades.
That's so well put, Lindsay. You got it. You've captured it. And this is what Lindsay and I were speaking about the other day. And when she was asking me, like, hey, what could we talk about? I thought, well, I don't want to talk necessarily specifically about meditation, because meditation is a sort of a personal, sometimes it has religious aspects to it, spiritual aspects to it, which in itself is not bad. But stepping back from that and saying, yeah, but why is that? And so the why is it is that...
What do you mean, why is it? Why is what?
So why does that happen?
Why does what happen?
Why is it that when people meditate, they get this overwhelming sense of calmness? Why do the Buddhist monks do this? Why has this been going on for a few thousand years? Why do different religious traditions all have aspects of sitting in silence, sitting quiet?
You're a spiritual counselor, so do you encourage the people that you counsel to meditate?
Totally. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We have a couple of online Zoom groups One meets on Monday, one meets on Fridays, and I host that. And part of what we do to bring us to this very contemplative state, we use the word contemplative, where we have an awareness of our inner being, our inner self, and that's usually sitting in silence. I have not promoted because I think it's not necessary for the group that I have. Just like you said, many people for years have practiced and learned the art of meditation. But if you wanted to, what I would say, fast track that, binaural beats might be the way to do that. And so what I wanted to do was talk a little bit about, so how can I do that? Do I have all the tools? Everybody has the tools. Look, Lindsay's wearing a set of iPhone headphones, right? Everybody's got an iPhone. These all work, or a smartphone. These all now work in stereo. And so, but let me just back up a little bit and say, well, what is it that we're trying to accomplish by doing this on the mechanistic level? So if you've heard, people have heard about an encephalogram, electroencephalogram, where they put electrodes around your brain and they can detect activity in your brain. And the activity in your brain, because your brain literally is very much like a digital computer. The neurons are firing to each other, and depending upon what state of mind you're in, if you're in REM sleep, deep sleep, actively meditating, actively concentrating or focusing, stress, your brain is going at these different frequencies. And so there's this word called entrainment. And I know we were talking about that the other day. There's this word called brain entrainment.
Can you spell that?
Yes. So E-N-T-R-A-N-M-E-N-T. That comes actually from the world of physics. And I'll tell you a very interesting thing that happened. It was noticed in the 1600s by a physicist. Everybody knows what a pendulum clock is. It's a thing that keeps time because a pendulum is swinging back and forth and back and forth. Okay. If you had, and this is what the physicist noticed in the 1600s, he had two pendulum clocks for some reason on the wall of his house, and they were out of phase. So this one, when this one was swinging this way, this one happened to be swinging that way when the clock got set. Then he noticed a couple of days later, they were both swinging together. They entrained each other. Now you might think this is sort of mystical and there's a supernatural explanation, but no, what happens is the pendulum clocks are on the wall. And when things are out of phase, energy gets transmitted, in this particular case, through the wall itself, so that the other pendulum senses the motion of the other one, and eventually they call entrain. They swing now at the same frequency.
This is why it's so important to pick the right person to marry and the right friends to hang out with, because your energy is affected by that which is around you.
That right? is so true. That is so true. This is called synchronicity, or being in sync. You know, when someone says, oh, I like that person, I'm really in sync. Turns out to be Lindsay and I actually are in sync. We build on each other. You know, we spend 30% of our time during the day saying, I didn't know that. And it goes both ways. This is called being in sync. It's true with pendulum clocks. Let me give you another example that your audience will know this. How often have you heard some music that has a really good beat to it, and you start tapping your finger or tapping your foot to the beat? You've become entrained to the music.
So you're saying that this biurnal,
yeah,
it's biurnal, a sound in one ear, a slightly different sound in the other ear, then influences the resonance of your brain. It entrains your brain to reduce stress and over time make you feel better. I know your wife, who is mm-hmm. a PhD, heads the leadership engineering program at the University of Boston, right?
Tufts University.
Boston. Yep. Okay. Mm-hmm. She has started to do this a few months ago and is almost addicted to it because it has helped her, without a lot of muss and fuss, to feel so much more relaxed. You can hear it in conversation with her.
Yes.
She's gone down a few decibels and yeah. she's more relaxed by just using 20 minutes a day
yes.
of putting these headphones on with an app you can get on your phone, which we're going to have in the show notes, the app on the phone, the name of it, the link to the randomized study that he's going to talk about, because they've been taking a look at using this technique to reduce stress of people who are going into surgery. Right. That's how they're in the modern times started to take a look at the effectiveness of this easy way to entrain your brain without having had 20 years of being sitting on the mat.
Correct. And without trying to intervene pharmacologically. So in other words, the doctor
without Xanax.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And I think this fits right in with what we'll call the philosophy of functional medicine. This is a functional thing. You can do it chemically, but there's all sorts of side effects chemically. Are there side effects from listening to binaural beats? Yes, if you are prone to epileptic attacks or any kind of seizures, you wouldn't want to be doing this. Because what's going on when you do this? They know from encephalograms that your brain goes at different frequencies that I just mentioned a while ago. When you are in a real deep sleep and you're experiencing very, very deep sleep, your brain is slowed down to what is called the delta waves. So your brain is cycling at 1 to 2 cycles a second. So that's 1 to 2 cycles a second. When you're very highly engaged, concentrated, activating, it's going at 30 cycles a second, like that. It's a very high frequency. And so the idea is, if I'm feeling anxious and stressed, who isn't? COVID, the elections, jobs, who isn't? Sitting then and putting the headphones on and listening to, say, for instance, a frequency difference, which is about 6 cycles a second. In other words, it's sort of active relaxation. You're not sleeping, nor are you hyper. You're approaching what normally people would approach if they're experienced meditators. You listen to this beat, and your brain starts, just like the pendulum, your brain starts to say, I will start engaging with that and training with it. And you will feel the sense of reducing an anxiety. And you will. These studies have been done. However, and
how soon does someone feel that that improvement in their emotional state?
Are you talking about once you put the headphones on, how long do you have to wait before you? It's like 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. You probably want to have, if you do this, and there's still some controversy associated with it, and I'll get back to that in a second, but 20 minutes a day. Maybe 30 minutes a day, certainly not more than probably 30.
So if you're doing, so in the randomized trials, when people were doing this and they were doing 20 minutes a day, how many days and weeks did it take for people to say, boy, you know, I'm a lot more comfy inside myself now. I feel like I've just come down. You know, usually people use drugs to take the edge off reality. We're using this technique to take the edge off reality. How long did people say on the average of applying this 20 minutes a day did it take?
10 to 20 days.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, so let me caution you with, it's the same thing when we talk sometimes about in functional medicine, certain supplements. In terms of, well, it works well for some people, doesn't work well for others. You know, I think, and you're the functional medicine doctor, but I think as an example, in the medical community, when a pharmaceutical company introduces a new drug, they test it with tens of thousands of people. They're looking for the 95% effect. If there's a safe supplement that one can take, or binaural beats, for instance, to reduce anxiety, if it works for 30% of the people, well, why wouldn't you at least try it? There's no harm in it, you see? And so, therefore, the recommendations, you know, some of the people would say, oh, no, this has been tested, doesn't work. Then there are other people saying, well, we've tested it, we've measured 26% in one of the studies. There, in fact, is, even to this moment right now, a clinical study and a clinical setting going on to test, because men respond to it very different than women. Men are much more likely to hear the binaural beat than women. Interestingly enough,
meaning the difference between one ear and the other?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So when you put the headphones on, one person might say, I don't hear that, say, 6 or 7 hertz beat. Here's a very interesting thing. It turned out to be that women, during their menstrual period, during that time that their estrogen level is high, they don't hear the beats. This is
so,
a study.
So because men hear more of the beat, will they get better benefit from it? I don't know what that translates into, the difference of doing this type of de-stressing regular activity. So what's the difference between men and
women?
So
I don't think that's been clinically studied enough to be able to say. This, like any type of medicine that's been tested to see the efficacy, in this binaural beat research, It's done certainly well within the medical community, because the medical community is always interested in to have patients before they arrive for surgical procedures. Everybody's anxious when they go for a surgical procedure. How do I reduce the anxiety stress level of the patient? So the medical community looks at it, and also what I will call the psychiatric, psychological community is also looking at it. It's a very interesting, and because every person's brain is different, and because the brain is the uncharted territory, naturally, some people will say, we did the study, we didn't see any effect at all. Others say, hey, we did the study and we found great differences. There's enough stuff there to say, you should try it. You should look into this.
Okay, so the one contraindication is if you have a history of seizures, if you're epileptic, you shouldn't be doing this. Does that mean if you have Parkinson's disease or any other neurodegenerative disease, you should avoid it? Or is that helpful for those patients?
Actually, I actually read about that in the Parkinson's disease. It does help, because, you know, in Parkinson's disease, there is a dysfunction in the neural connections in the brain. And in fact, one way that Parkinson's disease is treated non-chemically or non-pharmacologically is to have implants in the brain to help regulate and to synchronize actually brain activity.
So they would probably be especially helped by this. So people just purchase a little headset,
a good set of stereo headphones.
Do you have your headphones here?
What happened?
No, don't go.
We're not going to go anywhere.
No, so basically
regulate,
you buy little teeny headphones. Even the earbuds from your phone would work.
Here they are.
And
right
then
behind,
which is the
right
app?
Behind me? Can I get
Nope.
Okay.
Which is the app?
So the app, you can... Let's put it this way.
What's the name of the app on the phone that
they would get? The name of the app.
And is it free or does it cost anything?
No, it's free. I'm going to be turning this back on because I wanted to make sure it was
off.
I can tell your audience, one place to go look for this is go to YouTube and look for binaural beat relaxation. Or there's hundreds.
Spell it out one more time.
Yeah, B-I-N-A-U-R-A-L. And usually they use the word beat, binaural beat, binaural beats.
Which I kind of like since I'm a dancer, so that was pretty attractive.
Yeah,
I've only tried this once the other evening when he was explaining to me that his wife had started to use this easy 20-minute a day relaxation form that has been extremely effective for her. And she is a scientist also. She's a PhD in engineering, and her mind is going, going, going. And with everything else going on the planet, it's going, going, going. And how long did it take for her to report back to you? Because she's a very, very truthful and very self-aware person, but she was uptight. How long did she say, I love this and I want to continue to do this every day?
It was after the first time she tried it. So we normally, when we're together in the same place, we normally do 20 minutes of meditation anyway. Meditation from a prayer perspective. And then I knew she always sort of struggled, because she would say, yeah, I can't meditate. My mind goes a mile a minute. I have all these thoughts. They're distracting. And I said, you know what? You should try this, because I read an article published in the medical journals about how it was used to calm people down before. So I said before surgery.
And which surgery was that?
It was eye surgery. I think both cases I read were related to either cataract surgery or something. And I think that's probably one of the, and this is sort of inpatient, outpatient kind of surgery. I think a lot of ophthalmologists realize people are very anxious if they have to have any kind of operations on their eyes. So they thought this was very useful. So some of the patients, they would have them practice this 20 minutes, 30 minutes a day, about a month before the surgery. But they even see an effect if before you go immediately into your surgery, either anywhere from 30 minutes to 1 hour sitting in a quiet room with the headphones on, listening to it. And when you're done, you go in.
So while you're waiting to get your surgery, you could take your earphones and your phone and do a 20-minute session to just get yourself in a more meditative state. What's the name of the app on your phone that people would get, and it's free?
You know, I'm going to – it's
– So it's B-I-N-A-U-R-A-L, binaural beat. That's
right.
What this is. And if you put that in your search bar, you should be able to download some free apps. One's called
Binaural Generator. Binaural generator.
So it's free. You could just use the earphones if they plug into your.
I don't know if I want to put this up against the screen where people might be able to see it.
I think they could see
So you see what you're able to adjust is the adjustments are, what is the difference in frequency that you want? So something like 1 or 2 would be deep sleep. Something like 6 to 9 would be meditation. And underneath it, you'll see something called, what's the base frequency? The base frequency is sort of this background carrier that is in the background that you do hear. The best range they discovered is around 400 cycles per second, 400 hertz.
Well, this is really cool because it's like saying, okay, I'm feeling out of sync and I want to get my brain back in sync. It's kind of like doing yoga daily, going to the gym daily, those kind of things. Or if you belong to my membership, we try and have a safe space of community that you could also plug into that sets your day. So don't forget, I've launched a new membership and you can find out all about it. Real easy way to just take a look at it at drlindseyberkson.com/membership. And we're trying to create the same thing with a membership to reset our sense of calm and community. Happiness and knowledge is power. So becoming more powerful in times when you don't know whose news to trust. So if you trust Dr. Berkson's Best Health Radio and you trust
And we do trust Dr. Berkson. We do trust her. I learned so much from her. It's incredible.
So this has been so helpful. You know, yesterday we reset our brains.
We certainly did.
We went out on a boat and we went through all the mango groves and ended up at a place called Dog Island or Dog Beach,
they call it, yes.
Where everybody, so I live in Austin, Texas, generally, and we have dog parks where people bring their dogs and you can let them off the leash and enjoy them, and there's doggies everywhere.
And they all get along.
This is a dog beach, and the dogs were in the water, and you could see them barking and whining when they were getting closer and closer because they couldn't wait to get out of the boat.
Yes.
And you're throwing the dog, the ball, in the water, and dogs are leaping, all kinds of dogs, big Great Danes, little itty-bitty dogs, and they're in the water, and the water was crystal clear. And I jumped out and went swimming around, and it was like a dog beach. I'd never heard of that before.
And what did you notice? That all these different breed of dogs, we saw a Great Dane, we saw a little, I don't know what the name of the dog would be, but a little teeny tiny dog. Everybody got along. You would think if that many dogs are together, there's going to be a couple of bad dogs in there. We didn't see one bad dog. Everybody was happy. Just shows you that if you have respect, right, for one another, if the dogs can do it, we should be able to do it, right? Get along?
I think it shows you that water causes entrainment.
Ah,
I think the ocean, that's why everyone loves the ocean, the sounds of the waves, the negative ions, the beauty of where you have access to the ocean causes entrainment. It's the same way that greenery. There's all these studies with greenery that if you have places of greenery, you have a lot more calm because the brain is entraining with nature.
Yes.
Even if you just look sitting inside the house out a window at greenery, or if you don't even, you're in an apartment with a brick wall outside your window, if you have pictures on the wall of greenery, your brain entrains similarly to the
biurnal
exercise that we're telling you about that's free to entrain your brain to just feel more comfy in all these times of stress. Hope this has been really helpful for you. I want to thank you, Dr. Biola, or Mike as I know you.
And Dr. Lindsay is Lindsay as I know you.
This has been a wonderful visit.
It's wonderful that you're visiting me here. You visited me on Cape Cod, which was another beautiful setting. And I just want to add to that, you know, in nature, you know, so for some of you folks who say, you know, I have trouble going to sleep at night, but I bought myself this sound machine near my bed, and you can usually select different sounds. Have you noticed that they always have rainstorm sounds? It's the same kind of thing. The frequency of rain hitting against the window is the same kind of frequency that entrains your brain into go to sleep. So natural sounds, nature by its very nature, so to speak, to use the same word twice, has a certain frequency associated with it. This is why I think, as you just said, when you feel stressed, go into nature and listen to the sounds of the winds, the sounds of the rain, the sounds of the waves splashing against the ocean. It's that frequency.
Maybe that's why people like even lying in the bathtub. If you don't have access to the ocean, if you don't have access to greenery, sometimes women like to lay in the bathtub and there's a little hint of the water on the planet, by being in the water with your body submerged. That's so right. You can always, no matter your situation of where you're living, maybe because of the pandemic.
Yeah.
Sorry, yeah. You know, some people are stuck in a home with someone that's abusive to them,
yeah,
and negative, even just closing the door,
yeah,
and getting in the tub and, you know, and then having moments of downloading this free app. There are things that you can do to change your level of stress. Knowledge is power, and why not take charge of how you feel so you don't have to suffer so much? You can make it a smaller font size.
That's right. You got to build your own refuge. You can build your refuge wherever you are. And it does. It also includes music, you know. So I just maybe want to close with this, because a lot of the clinical studies that have been done to say, well, did the binaural beats themselves do anything? Or is it just sort of sitting, listening to something soft? People are going to be very aware of, for instance, the music of Johann Sebastian Bach. You study his music, and this is in the Baroque period, and others did it. The beat is 60, it's 1 per second, 1 per second. I can think of many pieces of music by Bach, which for me, this is why I like playing music by Bach on the piano. It causes your heart rate to try to entrain with that beat. Compare listening to that versus listening to like a rock piece. The rock piece is probably the 20 to 30 cycle, gets you very agitated, engaged. Music by Bach calms you down, and this is known.
So at these political rallies where people are going, lock her up, or wherever that doing, yeah, is there a beat to that? I mean, I just thought of this now that you're saying that, because people can jump on a collective angry beat.
Yeah. That's a great observation. I hadn't thought of that, Lindsay, until you just mentioned
either,
it.
I hadn't thought of it either, but I was...
But this is what goes on, you know? And in fact, think about in times in the past, before the men went into battle, didn't they, you know, bang their spears? Or at least you see depictions of that in the Roman Empire. They get the troops all wound up. That energy now goes from here, goes in here to the muscles. So
what could we do for calm if we were doing a rally that was uplifting and calming at the same time, which is kind of two different emotions? What might be a, because satsang, I remember when I lived with Swami Satchinanda, you're all sitting around, you do om. You'd have a whole group of everybody doing om. And that would be in training everybody to get your brain to a calming, but uplifting, yet powerful space.
You know, when you, we haven't rehearsed this, by the way.
No,
so I just want people to know that this is all happening the way it happens anytime Lindsay visits me. When you mentioned that and you talked about rally and how can you turn it into something peaceful, I immediately thought of Martin Luther King. When his people were together, say, for instance, Selma, weren't they going side by side? We shall overcome. Think of that beat. Think of the movement. And people, I believe, left that rally peaceful and loving. And compare that to, like you just said, ones where you're holding up your fist in anger and chanting anger things. People walk away from that, they're angry. This is why I think it's a great disservice that some of these rallies are fueling their minds, fueling their energy to destruction rather than peaceful.
And that's what we need right now, is to bring everyone together. And how do you do this when you're so polarized? But I remember the studies from my alma mater at the University of Michigan, where this study has been replicated over and over again, that if women hang out and they chit-chat in a way that's comforting, all of the women start to produce more progesterone.
Yes.
Which is a hormone of calm.
Yes.
And it also has metabolites that are neuroprotective for your synapses, for your cerebral spinal fluid, for your parasympathetic nervous system. So gathering together with friends, with uplifting thoughts, and with some kind of calming beat to it, will bring more of all of that to each of those who are present.
Yes, that's true. Just to mention something else that I read in the medical journals, and this had been published many, many years ago. As an example, when you bring groups of women together who are living together in terms of entrainment, their cycles match.
Right.
After a certain period of time, just that.
Right. There's a name for that. I think it's called the McClintock effect, I think.
Yeah, I think it is.
I think it is.
I read
Boy,
that.
Pulling that out.
See where that's
we're
where
in
that
trainment, so I could go easily since I'm calm with sitting and talking to you.
Yeah.
I was able to access
and
that,
get that
bit of data.
Because that's an old study. That's an old study. No, I think it is accurate. Yeah.
This has been great, and I hope that you've been entrained with us as we are with each other, because now I feel more calm than when I even began this show. So don't forget, if you want to learn about the new membership, go to drlindseyberkson.com/membership and stay tuned for more shows to come from Florida, and may the biurnal force be with you.
To all you, peace.
Peace.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.